Why did you decide to use both Sen and Sharma?
I decided to keep Sen Sharma because my parents asked me when I was about 5 or 6 that do you want to be Sen or do you want to be Sharma? Obviously, I felt if I say Sen, my dad will feel bad. If I say Sharma, my mom will feel bad. So I said, I'll be both. Some days if I have to do a very tense scene, you know, some situation in my real life which I may have dealt with quite easily, I'll use it to kind of feel a little sad or feel a little angry, unnecessarily have some tension with this real life person, poor thing.
Like, are you a perfectionist with your actors and actresses?
I may be a little like, oh, I want this exactly or that exactly. But you know, I'm also learning. Most of the time, I feel very gender neutral myself. I don't particularly feel like a woman all the time
that.
Or like a man or anything. I just feel quite like just a human being. I actually feel that I have really a very, very privileged life, and actually so has my mother. It's not like this for most women. I never wanted to be an actress. I thought, okay, I'll just do a few films and I'll get a real job. So I never really cared about it.
Konkana Sen Sharma, welcome to Town Hall. Look at this audience, they've been sitting like good little children just waiting for you.
Sweet.
I've been sitting like a good little child waiting for you.
I got lost, you know. Okay.
It happens. You are like a chameleon. You're diverse, you're varied. And I always wonder, you know, you fit into every character that you do so incredibly well, despite whatever upbringing every actor has. So what's your process? How do you find the, you know, the nitty-gritty of that character?
I have to say that I don't really have a fixed process, and I'm generally quite flexible about that. One of the things which are common to many setups is that, you know, invariably you will have a few readings. I like to read the script myself a few times. And sometimes there are workshops, which not all films have. But if you do like an acting workshop or something, that's great, because then, you know, you can kind of go through the scenes in advance. What has happened just before the scene, which may not be in the script, but for you to know, oh, actually, I've just come from the doctors, this particular character, and therefore good news or bad news. So you know what kind of a thing you're entering the scene with. Those kind of things, it's always nice to kind of go over your scenes like that. The other thing which really helps me, and I would say is part of prep, which all films seem to do nowadays, earlier not all films did, is the look test. You know, costume trial with hair, makeup, wardrobe.
So that helps you get into a character?
Yeah, because you know what happens at least is that you're working kind of from the outside in. You know, and I remember with Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, one of my early films, it really helped because it was such a completely different get-up of this Tamilian woman. So, you know, everything was... there was a reason, whatever their Mangalsutra, which is the tali, the sindhu, whatever, the sari, the heels, the bag, the baby, everything, those were all little cues, you know, like Pavlovian responses I had to it. So that really helped me kind of prep for the role. My mom, of course, is brilliant and she's a great help, because she would at home just casually start talking to me in a Tam accent. And I used to initially feel very shy. I'm anyway generally a bit shy, and I used to not want to kind of, you know, venture to speak in that accent, but she would constantly talk in this accent, even when we were just going out for lunch or shopping or some errands, this and that. She and I would talk like this in the car. So I just became used to it.
It just played off. You know, you've heard of the method actors, the guys and girls who lock themselves in the rooms and for months they don't get out of that actor. Does that ever happen to you? Do you feel consumed by your character sometimes? Or is it like a switch for you? Like you said, you put on the clothes and then you're in character.
No, I don't think it's a switch. I think a part of it is intuitive and you're just feeling your way around, so you're not exactly sure what exactly prep is. One thing which helps is, you know, if I know I'm supposed to be this kind of a person, I have noticed that I start molding my life experiences according to this person that I'm supposed to be. So I found that on some days if I have to do a very tense scene or a very sad scene, you know, some situation in my real life which I may have dealt with quite easily, I'll use it to kind of feel a little sad or feel a little angry, unnecessarily have some tension with this real life person, poor thing, and then use it in my scene. So I'm just manipulating my real life in very small ways, you know, to kind of tweak it to the experiences I need to have for my shoot, which could be a dangerous thing.
We're just assuming that directing was easy for you because you're such a talented, you know, actress. Was it?
No, I was terrified.
Yeah?
But I'm generally terrified. I mean,
oh, the spotlight.
Yeah,
but you're
yeah.
behind the camera.
I start with being terrified and slowly it gets better. And you know, I've noticed this with me particularly, it works well. If you generally have low expectations from life and from other people particularly.
That's
if you have low expectations from other people, then you know, at least you're not you're prepared and you're not surprised. Hmm. And then, you know, they can always, you know, prove your expectations wrong, which is so fantastic.
Sure.
But it's great not to expect things from other people.
Did you have a vision of how you wanted to direct, because you worked with so many? Was there something particularly you said, I won't do
yes,
this?
Yes, I didn't want to be screaming and shouting on set. You know, the way we perceive authority, it's ingrained in our conditioning, how we perceive. One person starts screaming and shouting, we'll all be like, huh, what happened? You know? But when people say some things quietly and firmly, then they don't listen. That's why if protests have to turn violent before people listen to what the problem is.
So were you able to make everyone listen on set?
I think largely. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, to begin with, if you're already the director, then that helps because, you know, you've also written, directed, they know, you know, you've had those, you've done your prep. So that helps. But I didn't want screaming and shouting on set because that's not the environment in which I function best. Mm. Honestly, if there's a lot of screaming and shouting, I'm not, you know, and if somebody's shouting, I can't usually understand what they're saying. Because I'm just like, oh my God, this person is shouting. That's what I'm thinking, you know. I'm not thinking of, oh, but this and that, you know. I can talk normally, acha, you are feeling like, okay, but I feel like, you know, this. And oh, but why, you know, I can have a conversation, I can have a discussion. I am also hot-tempered, I also have a short fuse and all of that. And those are things I have been working on long-term. And I truly believe that it's not a great environment to bring out the best in people. People have to feel non-threatened and comfortable to bring out the best in them, ideally.
Being an actress, does it bring out the best in your actors when you're directing? You think that's...
I don't know. You'll have to ask them. I think I was a little too particular. I get, not that anybody told me straight.
Like, are you a perfectionist when you come to, think, with your actors and actresses?
You know, I think I'm very particular, which can be a little, you know, like they may feel hemmed in.
Yeah.
So it's not like they've directly come and told me, but I feel I've gathered this, that I may be a little like, oh, I want this exactly or that exactly. But you know, I'm also learning.
Yes.
And there have been times when I've been pleasantly surprised as well. Mm. I think it's nice to go in with like, I want this, and then to at least have an open mind to see what can happen.
Is it tricky? I mean, what brings you much more joy? Seeing your baby come into the screen and edited and written the way that you want, or bringing a role to the screen in perfection? Because you've got awards for both, for directing and for acting. So what brings you more joy?
I think definitely it was directing Death in the Gange. And also the process of writing it. I wrote with a fantastic colleague called Disha Rindani, and we had such a wonderful time writing. And the joy and the high of directing, though of course it was, you know, the thing is that the directing and putting this film out from the beginning to putting it out, it's not one emotion. Mm. Like motherhood, for example, it's not one thing. It's also frustrating, it is also exhausting, it is also stressful, it is also deeply meaningful, it is also, you know, it makes you expand as a person. So it's many things together. But at the end of it, to create a world, you know, sometimes I would be amazed that I feel like my cast and crew, I would feel like it's amazing because these guys have come to play with me. I really used to feel like it's like they've come to play with me, because it's like I thought this thing in my head and now they're playing with me. I just found that amazing. I'm so grateful to have had that team.
You've been brought up amongst film and liberal arts, and that's your life. And because you started so young, her first acting role was when she was 4.
Yeah.
So what was your first impression of set? Do you remember? Like 4 years you acted.
No, I can't remember because I've been going since I was a baby.
So there was like no memory that
there's
that
no
stays
first time.
You.
It's like I don't know the first time I watched a film because it they were always there. Playing.
That's amazing.
You know, and I was taken, and my mother never had these things about you can only watch a certain, you know, this is an adult film, so you can't watch it, or, you know, that. So I watched all kinds of films, regional films, European films, you know, grown-up films and film festivals and all kinds of films I used to watch. And I wasn't really told that you can't, except for some Hindi films.
Mainstream?
And the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, which came on TV, that I was not allowed to watch.
Did any of you watch that Ramayana?
No, they're too young.
They're too young to remember any of this, right?
No, because my mother was like, you know, first you read the epics.
Yes.
You imagine
enough.
It yourself.
Absolutely.
Then you see somebody else's maybe tacky version and you figure what you want to do.
But that's, so everyone's telling you, you've got to be an actress, you're so talented, which we all know, she's so talented. So it changed a little bit in college, didn't it? Like, when you did a couple of films in college.
You know, in college what happened is, I was actually so shy that I didn't participate. In my first year of college, I was too shy to audition in front of my seniors.
So no dramatic
society?
I
did backstage. Oh, I did backstage and props, and my friends were acting and stuff, and it was great, and I was very comfortable. Then I think by the time my second year came around, I kind of was more comfortable, and then, you know, my friends and I were doing, so we did some plays together. Mm. So I did a lot of plays at that time, and I really enjoyed it. I was then offered a Bengali film, which I wasn't sure if I wanted to do, because, you know, I've always been a bit snobbish. I was terribly snobbish at that time. I was studying Theatre of the Absurd in college, mm-hmm. and this was a very... and I didn't understand it at the time. It was a very negative character. It was a very mainstream kind of sensibility. It was a remake of a B-grade Hollywood film. Mm-hmm. So I was very embarrassed by the whole thing, even though the director was a lovely person and the film did very well. And many people liked it a lot and I got some awards, but mm-hmm. I was just very uncomfortable with the whole process. But I did it as a lark. I did it between my second and third years of college because I was told... I thought, okay, let me try it out, and, you know, I mean, it's supposed to be interesting, and I never really thought what will happen, will it release, will it, you know, will people, other people, I never thought that far. I didn't care, I never wanted to be an actress. I thought, okay, I'll just do a few films and I'll get a real job. So I never really cared about it. So, you know,
real job. The dream job. So what did you want to be? What was the real job you wanted?
So, you know, that's the problem, because it's not like I had very clear-cut notions, so I'm going to be an astronaut or whatever.
Yeah.
But I was going to say astrophysicist. I self-censored.
Astronaut is a good one, actually. Yeah.
So I didn't very strongly want to be any one particular thing. I did do, I enjoyed reading. So I did my bachelor's in English literature. And then I assumed I'd get a job, you know, something urban and shallow, like advertising or journalism. That's a line.
Shallow advertising.
A line straight out of English August, by the way, which I've just been like japping my whole life.
When you're growing up, you weren't allowed to watch what was sometimes very tacky cinema. So what comprises of that? Is it, you've also said, I don't do mediocre. So what do you mean?
When did I say I don't do mediocre? I've done many times mediocre. And
downright
terrible.
But you know what I mean. So for us, what comprises of that sort of tacky cinema?
I'm not saying that it's terrible and shouldn't exist. Of course it should exist and many people like to watch it. That's fantastic. What happens is that a lot of our funds and resources go into only one kind of cinema and not into anything else. Or very limited in other areas. You know, I feel like, you know, human beings, you know, we're all there's just a common humanity amongst all of us, you know, and all of us, you know, go through fear and loneliness and love and loss. I mean, these are just common human, I don't know, things that we have to go through, emotions and rites of passage or life experiences that most people go through, and some people are more difficult and others easier. I feel representation on screen of that is something, and you know, you find that in books many times. When I read something and I'm like, oh my God, this resonates with me. And yes, it is like this to live my life. Yes, I have felt these things and I have not been able to articulate, you know, it so well. But yes, I've had these life experiences and so have other people, and then they have put it across so well. So it's very enriching, you know. So if you can have that, you know, in films, you know, and you're... Basically, what I don't want is stereotypes, you know, because that's very limiting and it's very confining. It's just very unimaginative. And where is it taking you? I mean, it's not pushing anything. It's boring, because a stereotype is just something which has been repeated ad nauseum. I like characters who are going through some kind of transition, you know, who don't remain the same, or who are broadening their horizons, or I keep saying that, but characters who go through some kind of a change, not necessarily like all my life. I've noticed I've been offered mostly very good and earnest women.
Yeah.
Very good and morally upright. By and large, you know, I have played very morally upright women. Very earnest, very good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Full of integrity. I'm not necessarily like that in real life.
We're not complaining. But
women don't have to be so morally upright all the time. That's what I'm saying. This is put upon women. You'll rarely see women characters being irresponsible, taking bad decisions, and still being lovable or being relatable or having an understanding or sympathy.
I don't know if I agree with your character in Omkara being completely morally up. You know, that is one of her roles that really stays with me. There's that scene where you're looking down at the well and you're just, I mean, that I, sometimes when I think of you, that's the first scene that I think of because that's the impression that you've made. I mean, that's, you know, it stays with me. So I'm not so sure if you think you're, uh-huh. I'm not so sure if actually, I think you're being able to get across shades of different emotions and different right. morals in your characters.
That's See, that's I mean. Also Vishal's script and his direction. It's also Shakespeare's work. And the other characters have really not been behaving well.
Exactly.
In comparison, so maybe in my comparison. Characters really well behaved.
Maybe in actually, comparison. Yeah. The work-life balance?
The work-life balance.
How do you do also, it? Yeah. Give us some advice. I mean, it's yeah. a tough one.
Yeah, it is very tough. And it's a daily struggle, frankly. I'm again looking for a nanny. I mean, I find that
I'm... any recommendations?
You know, this is the other thing I remember. You know, people used to say... This about women that, I remember growing up, I've heard this a lot, you know, that, oh, so-and-so aunties, they're always talking about domestic stuff. Mm. And why are they talking about it? Because it's ultimately falls on them.
Absolutely.
Because without reliable help, which is often at the cost of less privileged women, unfortunately, I would have no career or social life. You know, so... It's a very important part of life, and you know, you find this inspiration, like, or this balance, you have to find it daily. The bhai who comes to my house also has her children who she has to. So, I mean, many people have to, you know, many women, some men, have to negotiate this on a daily basis. So, you have to have other skill sets, you know, in life, not to fall apart like me when you're nannyless, or not to fall apart when a film doesn't do well, because you have other things to fall back on.
Ageism is a reality, body shaming is a reality, the way you need to look is a reality, yeah. even with your privilege and your upbringing.
That's true.
Have you
Which
faced it?
Yeah. Have I faced it? I don't know. Because I think I'm not even choosing to see it like that.
Okay, so you
I'm know. Like saying, I'm 40 years old, this is what I look like, this is what I do. I would like to keep working. Ideally.
But like you said, it's hard to maintain that. I just wonder whether you can tell us best whether this industry's perception towards not just women but mothers, has it changed? Is it easier to be a mother in this industry today?
You know, one of my favorite things to say in this regard is the first film I did after I had my son Haroon. The first film I did, I played a 60-year-old woman. So I was like, wow, you know, motherhood really ages you in the Hindi. In the cinema.
That's a big bit of a step, isn't it?
Yeah. No, but that's, of course, I mean, it's true. But after that, I did all kinds of other roles yeah. as well. I actually feel that I have really a very, very privileged life. And actually, so has my mother. Because even though, you know, for a lot of women, it's not like this for most women. It's not.
You've had an amazing upbringing, but do you feel that maybe as women, sometimes we don't speak up enough? Is there a perception that we're scared of, that we'll be labeled as... I tend to face it a lot. Don't speak up because you'll be labeled emotional. I mean, my role is gender neutral, right? So similarly, yours is
yeah.
in a way.
So this aspect I've not seen because I'm telling you, I've come from a place of privilege.
So you've never had that
sort I've not had this problem. I've also been... I mean, other than being really shy when I was young, which I think even had I been a boy. But I actually most of the time feel very gender neutral myself. I don't particularly feel like a woman all the time.
That.
Or like
yeah.
a man or anything. I just feel quite like just a human being. A lot of the time. In fact, sometimes I'm like, oh, that was quite feminine of me. And I feel quite excited. I still learn things about being a woman and how there's so many different ways that you can be a woman. You know, and then there's not one way to be a woman or what is considered feminine. Or how important that is. So that is something I'm still kind of learning, and a lot of that actually learning came to me post motherhood, because I think before that I just didn't really particularly feel, I felt quite gender neutral, or what is that called?
Gender neutral, I get what you're
androgynous.
Saying.
Androgynous.
Is it your latest most interesting challenge being a mother? It's a different role.
He's 8 and a half.
Yeah.
Struggling to keep the dark aspects of myself contained.
Yeah. Isn't it exciting to be bringing up a young man and getting a chance to shape him to be the kind of man that, you know, we should
to
see.
Be the kind of human being
a
that
human
he wants
being,
to
actually,
be.
Yeah.
Yeah, be the kind of human being that he wants to be. That's the main thing, no? what he wants to be now. You know, very little control actually you have. You can try to provide the right environment, maybe bring up the right issues from time to time. When he was younger, we would do this, you know, like in the balcony. I remember we could see, often on Sundays, we could see, you know, a football game being played outside. And I, so, you know, often Harun and I would be sitting in the balcony and chatting, and I would, and we'd be, well, they're playing football, or this team is winning, whatever, you know, I mean, he didn't. And then, you know, saying that, notice how they're all boys who are playing. And where are the girls?
So you'd have those conversations.
Yeah, and I wonder where the girls are. What do you think they're doing? It's not like I know like any particular answer to give him, but just to become aware of these things. And you know, that he has chores around the house. Like it's his job to set the table like twice a day. Sometimes he's like, I don't want to. And I'm like, but I'm sorry, but that's your job. Sometimes we, and to do things even when you don't feel like doing them is such a great life learning for all of us. And you know, or you know, I remember when he wanted to wear nail polish, because you know, I often wear nail polish, my sister does, and he said, he was very young, so I had to say that, you know, let's nail polish is not for children, but perhaps yes, once you are older you can decide whether you want to wear nail polish or not. But you know, the thing is that they get so many influences from outside, because obviously in our household we never pushed any, you know, gender-specific toys or colors,
on a person.
But and his favorite color was pink, and we were like, okay, great. He came back from school one day betrayed, because he was like, you didn't tell me that pink was a girl's color. So then, you know, I was like, but why? I mean, I love blue. So you know, you have to counter also. I mean, these kind of things, and then they'll be who they want to be, and then I don't really know how much you can do about it.
In this age that we live in, there's a woke generation that's roaming around that has a lot of voices. Woke generation on social media that has a lot of voices, and it's
no,
see, they're all laughing because they're guilty.
Because they're guilty. Huh?
They're all, but that's the point. Look, the world that we live in requires a bit of social commentary. So, what do you take inspiration from today around the world that we see after all the experiences that you've had?
Well, right now I have to say Greta Thunberg.
Yes.
Who is, you know, the 16-year-old climate change activist. Yeah. So, I thought that was so inspiring, because there was that image of her sitting alone the first day that on the strike. She was sitting alone. She didn't go to school that Friday, and she was outside the UN building or something with one placard alone. And then a year later, she's got millions
world,
of people across the world, you know, with her on this extremely important issue. So I would say that's my current inspiration. So, you know, to have a voice and to know what is right or wrong, to speak your truth even if no one else will be there with you.
Are those the kind of films you watch? I mean, what do you watch on Netflix or...?
I watched that fantastic film recently called Parasite. Bong Joon-ho. Yeah, which was amazing and really was social commentary in the trope of some other kind of genre, which is fantastic. What else am I watching? I watched Chernobyl, which I thought was fantastic. I watched Mindhunter 2. So a lot of Fleabag I love very much. So there's a lot of stuff I'm watching. Yeah. And see,
give us a good watch list.
That's another whole pressure on my mind, because when am I ever going to, there's too much to watch. So, and I don't actually watch at the speed, at the rate, my watching rate is, I mean, and once in a while, like Chernobyl, though, I really watched like quite a few episodes like this.
Yeah.
And you know, I was so scared. I thought, you know, from my AC, I was like, you know, are there radiation fumes coming from my AC? I don't know, like it really psyched me. I really enjoyed watching it.
Thank you for sharing that part of us here on Town Hall
today.
Thank
you so much. If you like this video, then please like, share and subscribe to Scoop Whoop Unscripted.
ये ना पूछो ज़िंदगी में कितने पल हैं, ये पूछो हर पल में कितनी ज़िंदगी है।
लिखने में अच्छा है, पढ़ने में अच्छा है, कोटेबल कोट है, अच्छा बोल दिया आपने। सच बताओ ना, हर चीज़ रोमांटिसाइज़ करा लो। कौन सीताराम येचुरी से? आपकी किताब मुझे मिली नहीं कहीं भी। मैं सीपी के हर बुक स्टोर में गया हूँ, मुझे किताब नहीं मिली।
यानी बिक गया? सब बिक गया।
कितनी सही बातें कर रहे हो आप।
जरा आप देखो, ये फैसिनेटिंग थ्योरी।
ऐसी बातें इस शो पे कभी नहीं हुई हैं, पता है ना आपको? नहीं, आप बस कह रहे हो कि चाइना इंडिया से बेटर है। मैं कह रहा हूँ नहीं, मैं सच्चा देशभक्त हूँ।
नहीं,
इंडिया के खिलाफ मत बोल देना कुछ। राहुल गांधी और सारी डेलीगेशन आप भी गए थे जब एयरपोर्ट पे रोक लिया था। तो करते क्या है फिर एयरपोर्ट पे? मतलब होता क्या आपके साथ फिर? क्या गार्ड जाते हैं आपको मारते हैं, क्या होता है?
इफ एवरीथिंग इज नॉर्मल लाइक द गवर्नमेंट क्लेम्स, व्हाई आर वी बीइंग स्टॉप्ड?
आप लोग दंगे कराओगे ना? कुछ नहीं।